How do I start this one? Same?
Same. Same.
Okay, we'll start the prayer. Om Gananam Sva Ganapadim Havamahe Kavim Kavinam Upamasya Vastravam Jyeshtarajam Brahmanam Brahmanaspatana Shranvan Nusibhishiradanam Om Shri Mahaganadhipataye Namah Om Drishabham Chashanīnām Vishvarūpamadābhyam Bhruhaspatim Varenyam Om Tadvishno Paramam Padam Sadāpasyanti Sūrayah Divi Vachakshurātatam Om Aum Shreem Shreem Kleem Hasau Jagat Prasut Jai Namah. Everybody say after me Hare Ram Krishna three times.
Om Hare Rama Krishna Hare Rama Krishna Hare Rama Krishna.
Okay, anybody has any questions from the last class?
Questions.
Yes.
What happens if Parna and Bhoga happens to be the same house? Will it ever happen between the Mahadasa and Antardasa if there is no...
Yeah, it can happen. Parna and Bhoga can be in the same house.
There is no specific rule for it.
Yeah. Basically, Parna will show where your effort is going and Bhoga will show what you are experiencing, what you are getting. If they are the same, basically you are putting your effort into something in which you are also getting some results.
And
if
the planets are in the same house, it can happen.
Yes.
Dasa Lada and Antardasa Lada are in the same house. Okay. And another question is, on the Tithi Pravesha chart, only the Tithi and Masam are same. Is it Nakshatram may not be same?
Nakshatram need not be the same.
Need not be the same.
Yeah. When the Tithi of your birth comes back, the nakshatram will be close to your original nakshatram, but it can be a couple of nakshatrams away.
Okay.
The only criterion is sun should be in the same sign as he was when you were born, and then sun and moon should be at the same distance. So when you were born, let us say sun was at the beginning of Pisces, and you were born on a particular tithi. When the same tithi comes back in the next year, sun may be at the other end of the Pisces. So then moon has to be at the same distance, so moon will also be away. By sun was, for example, at 5 degrees in your birth chart, 5 degrees Pisces. And this year, when your birth tithi came, let's say sun is at 25 degrees Pisces. So he's 20 degrees advanced. So moon, when the tithi comes, the criterion is sun should be in the same sign, and moon should be at exactly the same distance from sun as he was when you were born. So earlier, whatever distance was between 5 degrees Pisces, sun and moon, now same distance has to match with 25 degrees Pisces, sun and moon. So moon will basically be advanced by 20 degrees compared to his original natal position. So that means it's basically two nakshatras away.
Okay.
So it can happen. But if you see the birth nakshatra being Hasta, and in Tithi Pravesh chart you see Rohini, there is a bug in the software. It can be a couple of nakshatrams this way or that way. Basically 30 degrees.
Right.
30 degrees divided by 13 is basically 2-1 fraction. So three nakshatras. Maximum it can be off by three nakshatras. Either plus or minus. If it is more than that, there is a bug in the software. Okay?
About this nakshatras, if I want to find an order of nakshatras, and the ruler of the nakshatras, where I can be. And is it relevant to this Atma Karaka, and is there anything relevant to this other astrological point of view?
I did not understand the second part.
Question is,
can you repeat the
how do I find the order of...
Yes, that you can find from any book. For example, if you get my book,
uh-huh.
you have the list of nakshatras and the large of the nakshatras.
Okay.
So you can get it from any book. So I did not really specifically mention it.
Okay.
I can also give a table in a later class. But what is the second part?
Second part is, for example, this example what you have right now.
Yeah.
It's a Purva Bhadra, right? It's owned by Venus.
Which Purva Bhadra?
No.
Purva Bhadra is not Venus.
It's not Purva
Bhadra. Venus is what is in the bracket.
Okay, the one in the brackets is basically the lord of the nakshatra,
yeah.
And it's not Purva Bhadra. If you read it, you will see that it's Purva Shada.
No, I couldn't read it.
You want it to be bigger?
Sure.
Yeah. No, because it was okay. Purvashada.
Yeah.
Now it's that means moon is in the nakshatra. Moon belongs to the nakshatra of
Purvashada. Yes, moon is in Purvashada nakshatra, which is owned by Venus as per Vinshyotri Dasaski.
Okay, but does it have any relevance to this Atma Karaka and all those things?
No, they are totally different things.
Okay. And then Purvashada falls in the Sagittarius. That's what it is.
Yeah, Purvashada falls in Sagittarius. That's why you see moon in Sagittarius.
Okay.
And his question was, suppose somebody is born at this time.
Okay.
He is born on Krishna Trayodasi, which means he was born on Krishna Trayodasi with 75% of the tithi left. That means if you do some math, you will see that the distance between sun and moon has to be exactly certain number of degrees. Then only you get Krishna Trayodasi with 75% left. So there is a particular distance between sun and moon. If you see here, sun is here, moon is here. Sun is in Ketagan, moon is in Sagittarius. If you find the distance, it is maybe 340 degrees or 325 degrees, there is certain distance. Now, Tithi Pravesha occurs every year when sun is again in Capricorn and moon is exactly at the same distance. That is when the new beginning happens for the year. Okay? Okay.
It happens like twice in that same time. We take the later one?
We take the later one. But it's open to research. We can do some research on it. His question was, you have this concept of Adhikamasam.
Yeah.
So his question is basically related to that. What if when sun is in the beginning of Capricorn, the same tithi may have come, and when sun is at the end of Capricorn, again the same tithi may have come. It happens once every few years. So when it happens, how do you know which is the correct birthday for the, which one will tell you what will happen during the next year? So what we do in tradition is we take the second one.
And those who are born in Adhikamasam, like how their Tithi Pravesha will occur, it will occur at 12 years?
Yeah. His question is, when somebody is born, if there was an Adhikamasam, that means when he was born during this year, when sun was in the beginning of Ketukan and when he was at the end of Ketukan, the same city came. So he was born during the Adhikamasam, not during the Nijamasam. Then how do you define it? So all that is tricky.
Okay.
I don't have any clear views on it because I haven't worked a lot with that kind of charts.
Okay.
But what I was told by my guru is, doesn't matter whether the birth happened in Nijamasam or Adhikamasam, it is basically that tithi when sun is in that sign. So whenever it happens every year, that is Tithi Pravesha. You don't have to wait for so many years for that person's birthday to come. Like leap year, February 29th birth.
My question was, is there any significance of nakshatra versus any astrological?
Other factors you are saying. But Apagarga was just an example.
Yeah.
The nakshatra lord, yeah. Basically.
Yeah, does it have any significance?
It does have a lot of significance. If you are, for example, looking at the current dasha, let us say somebody is running. Let us take somebody who is born right now. So if you look at his dashas, for example, let's say moon dasha runs. From 2019 to 2029, this person will run moon dasha.
Right.
And moon is in whose nakshatra?
Purvashada,
which is owned by
Venus.
So moon is basically, as far as nakshatra is concerned, moon is under the influence of Venus. So who is Venus in this chart? What is his role? What is his agenda? That does have a role in deciding what results moon will get. So there is a significance, but we haven't done anything on nakshatra dispositor
okay.
So far. So for us, we don't care. We don't care about it right now, but it is important.
Okay.
So now I understand what you are asking. We'll do it slowly.
Okay.
Okay. Now, do you have any other questions? Anybody has any other questions? So we'll continue the discussion on Narayan Dasha, but you said you wanted to show an example. Do you want to do that?
No.
Okay. Is it your chart?
Yeah.
Okay. Seshu Garu wants us to see his chart. By the way, the two guys who are talking in the middle of the class, they are from New Jersey. Narayan Iyer and Suresh Babu, they are very good astrologers.
Narayan Iyer came once.
Yeah, he came once.
Both of them came actually.
Yeah.
This is related to career change and significant event.
You have opened the chart
time.
Okay.
You have opened the chart.
No.
Okay.
That's the area and...
Okay. We'll let other people guess. The date of birth is September 16, 1961. The time is 2:22 p.m. Indian Standard Time, and the place is Secunderabad, India, 78 East 30, 17 North 27. Now, I'll let you guys drive. Whatever you want me to open, I will open. He says that during this particular week, an important change happened in his week, in his career. Right? Is that right?
Right.
So there was an important change in his career. What kind of change could it be?
Which week?
Last week.
This week. The week that's over. Last week. So what technique do you want to apply? Do you want to first directly go to Sisi Pravesha?
We saw first
Narayan
Dasha, then after
that
we did
Sisi Pravesha again. Okay, let's just go to Sisi Pravesha right now to see, to get an idea of whether it's a good event or a bad event. So we should look for
2004
Sisi Pravesha chart. So 2004 Sisi Pravesha chart was on August 22, 2004 at 5:23:15 a.m. Who is the Hora Lord?
Mars.
The ruler of the year. Mars is the ruler of the year. He is the Hora Lord. So he shows the theme of the year. Now, if you go to Dashas, let's go to Dashamsa instead of Navamsa. We want to see something about his career. So Dashamsa, Mars is Lagna Lord. One second. We have 8 minutes leeway and 4 minutes 45 seconds leeway on both sides. So mostly, unless the time is totally off, okay. But we don't trust ourselves. Basically, when we look at a chart, no, the bottom line is when we fixed it, how confident were we? Were we confident that it could not be 2 seconds earlier? Were we confident that it could not be 2 minutes earlier? We have a window, basically. You never know the point of time. You only have a window. So for this year, when you look at the Dashamsa, it may be right on the border. 2 seconds earlier, it may be a different Lagna. If it is so close to the border, then you want to consider the other one also, because you are not sure. But here we have 8 minutes and four three quarters minutes leeway on both the sides. So we are safe mostly, unless the time is totally off. Now, what dasha is he running right now?
Master, if it happened before
When did it happen?
Mercury.
Mercury dasha.
So it happened at the end of Mercury dasha. Uh-huh. So Mercury dasha, Mercury antar dasha, the event happened between January 25 and February 4. Okay. So Mercury is the one who gave the result, good or bad. What kind of changes will Mercury give?
There is 8th Lord and 11th Lord in 12th house.
Yeah.
He can give shock in the chaos of career.
He can give?
He can give gains in the career as well as sudden shock.
Okay, 8th Lord, what will he give? Sudden shock?
Yeah. Then he's in 11th.
Does 8th Lord always give a negative shock or can it be a positive shock also?
Positive shock also.
Forget what you know about his case. In general,
they can give any shock.
Yeah, anything basically unexpected. Unexpected, unplanned things are given by the 8th Lord. And 11th house, he wants the 11th house of gains.
Yes.
Now, where is he placed?
He's in 12th house.
He's in the 12th house. Yes. Basically, is he a functional benefic or a functional malefic for this Lagna?
Functional malefic.
Malefic. Yeah. Because he's the 8th and 11th Lord. Yes. So, if the malefic is in the 12th house, is it good or bad?
Good.
It's good. So it's actually Viparit Rajyoga, Mercury 8th Lord being in the 12th house.
And then second, Mars is in second house of resources, which is Hora Lord for this year.
Yeah.
And then it's Lagna.
Right. But let's ignore the Hora Lord because his dasha is not running right now. Whatever the Hora Lord promises may have happened earlier or it may happen later. So
close actually. Mars was January 25th, it was ending.
Okay. No, I'm not talking about the Antardasa.
Okay.
I'm just talking about the ruler of the year will give the most important event of the year, but that will come during his dasa. So that may be something else. This may or may not be the most important event of the year, but what kind of event is it? So do you guys think it's good or bad? 8th Lord in the 12th house, is it a good change or bad change? Is it change, first of all? Do you think it's some kind of change?
Yes.
You guys know. Somebody else.
No, I also predicted. He
doesn't know.
He doesn't know? Oh, okay. Oh, good. Okay, that's good. Yeah. Because you guys were discussing, I thought.
No, we were like this.
Okay. How is Mercury placed in the Rasi chart? Because that is the physical. This is the professional environment. So in the professional environment, there is some kind of change, some kind of disturbance, some kind of shock, some kind of unexpected event, but it may be for his good.
Yeah.
But this is the physical existence, overall physical existence. And what is the impact of this event on the physical existence of the native? Is Mercury well placed or badly placed? What is the result given by Mercury here?
Mercury is
What houses does he own?
His third house and 12th and 3rd.
Yeah. Third lord and the 12th lord. And where is he placed?
Second house.
He's placed in the second house.
So he's equal that.
Whose business will Mercury get? As far as physical existence is concerned. As far as Rashi chart is concerned, Mercury is with three other planets. So they will exchange results.
He will exchange with Sun,
okay. Why? What is the order of beneficence if you arrange the four planets?
Jupiter, Sun, Mars.
No, not Sun. Jupiter?
Mercury.
Who is the second benefic?
Mars? No.
Who is most benefic out of other planets? If you leave out Jupiter, Sun, Mars and Mercury, who is the most beneficial?
Okay. Mercury.
Yeah, so Jupiter, Mercury, then
Sun,
and Mars is the worst benefic.
Yeah.
So when you arrange in this order, extend the first and last, second from last. So Jupiter will end up giving the results of Mars, Mars will end up giving the results of Jupiter, Sun will end up giving the results of Mercury, Mercury will end up giving the results of Sun. So as far as physical existence is concerned, Mercury is going to give the results of Sun during his dasha and antardasha. And are they good results or bad results?
Sun is in one house and
Sun is second lord in the second house.
House.
Second lord, basically second house of money, second house of resources. Yeah. So Sun is well placed. Sun is well placed. And we are only looking from Lagna so far. From Lagna, he is in the second house, second lord.
Mm-hmm.
But when you are looking at the material status, his image, what is more important than Lagna?
Arudha
Lagna, AL. Lagna is what who he is, what he is doing. Arudha Lagna is who he is perceived to be by the whole world. That is his maya, that is the image of the person. So look at Arudha Lagna. From Arudha Lagna, all these planets are in the 11th house. So planets in the 11th from Arudha Lagna should give
gain.
Yeah, some increase in the physical image, some increase in the material status, on ground status. So looking at that, do you again correlating this with the dashamsha? Do you think it was a positive change or a negative change?
Positive gain.
Okay, good. Now, what else do you want to see? Are you done with Tithi Pravesha?
We haven't discussed about
8-10
and GL.
Yeah, 8-10.
GL, forget it.
8-10 we
need to. Ghatika Lagna, in the Rashi chart, it changes once in every 24 minutes. In Dashamsha, it changes once in every 2 minutes. So we may or may not be right on that Ghatika Lagna. If it is right, then that's good. Planets in Ghatika Lagna usually give position. They give authority. They give power. They make the person more powerful. So if Ghatika Lagna is there, that's good. But we can't be 100% sure. Could be off. So usually my advice is don't use Hora Lagna and Ghatika Lagna in the divisional charts. Use them only in the Rashi chart. Okay. What else?
A10
and A2 are there. So he's impacting A10 and A2. What is the meaning of that?
A10
is Rajapada, basically.
Karma that is recognized by.
It's basically the formal job.
A10
is a formal job. So Mercury is in that house. So what does he promise? He's the 8th lord. 8th lord always promises. His agenda is change. He's the 8th and 11th lord. So change. He brings changes. And how does he bring changes? What are the arudhas that are impacted by this change? A10 and A2. So there can be some changes in the formal job, the formal work that he is doing. 10th house is the work that you do. A10 is the manifestation of the work that you do. So it's the formal classification of what work is he doing. Is he a software engineer? Is he a principal software engineer? Is he doing software work at Microsoft? Is he doing quality assurance? Is he doing this? Is he doing that? So when you say he's doing good work, he's doing good karma, he's an engineer, it's not really a tangible thing. When I say he's working as a senior quality assurance engineer, when he's working as a senior manager, when he's working as a director, when he's doing this, when he's doing that particular thing, specific thing is specific. It is tangible. It is a tangible thing. Doing good work is not a tangible thing. But working as a principal engineer is a tangible thing. So A10 is basically the tangible aspect of your karma. It is your formal job. It is the formal classification of your job. It's so-and-so engineer, like so-and-so company. That is A10. So if the 8th lord is in A10, there will be some changes or some disturbance or some uncertainty relating to the formal job. So usually, I don't know about his case, but usually when you see 8th lord in A10, we can expect some changes in the status during that time. During that particular dasha, he may get a promotion or he may get a demotion or his role may change, his title may change. Even if title doesn't change, he may be still software engineer, but until then he may be in development. Now he may start doing quality assurance work, or he may start doing diagnostics, he may start doing something else. So, 8th Lord in 8th Den can give some changes in the actual tangible job that you are doing. Okay, what else? Do you want to see anything else? Do you want to see from Aruhi Lagna? Because, like we said, Aruhi Lagna is the status. So, if you look from Aruhi Lagna, Mercury is placed in the 10th house. Is it a good placement for Mercury?
Yes.
Yes, it's a good placement. So, basically, as far as the image is concerned, during Mercury Dasha, Mercury Antar Dasha, the image will be that of somebody who is doing good, intelligent work. Mercury basically gives the, yes.
Are you taking Mercury as a benefit planet?
Yes.
Not natural benefit, not the functional nature.
Yes.
What does that mean?
What he said is, Mercury is basically the 8th Lord. So he is a male fit. So if you say, if you look at Mercury in the 10th from Aruhi Lagna, he's saying, should it be bad? When I say intelligent work, etc., I'm not looking at whether he's functionally benefic or malefic. He is Mercury. And Mercury shows a smart person, somebody who's intelligent, who analyzes well. So that's what Mercury shows. So that Mercury in Libra in a friendly house, Mercury is in a friendly house. Actually, is he in a friendly house or a very friendly house? Is he in Mitrasthana or Ajmitrasthana? Who remembers Ajmitra? Pardon me? Venus is friend, but is he a good friend? Is he an Ajmitra? Do you remember? We had permanent relationships,
yeah.
And we had temporary. Who is the temporary friend?
Next three houses, either side.
Yes, either side, next three houses. So from Mercury, if you see next three houses, and next three houses here, Virgo, Leo, Cancer, and here Scorpio, Sagittarius, Capricorn. Is Venus in one of those houses?
Yes.
He is, so he's a friend.
One plus
he's a temporary friend, yeah, 1+1. Temporary friend, and originally permanent friend. So together, he compound relationships wise also, he's a friend. He's a very good friend actually. If he's friend both the ways, he becomes very good friend. So Venus is a very good friend, Ajimitra. So Mercury is in an Ajimitra sthana and he is in the 10th from Aruhi Lagna. So the image people have of this person as far as work is concerned is that of a positive image of somebody who is intelligent, somebody who is very good in analysis, good in logic, somebody who is smart. But at the same time, the same Mercury is 8th Lord and 11th Lord. So you have to use both. Naisargika shows what kind of image. But functional nature wise, Mercury is a planet who shows change, who shows uncertainty. So again, that will also have an impact. He will be seen to be an intelligent person. That is definitely true. But at the same time, what is he doing? How is he doing? Regarding that, there will be some uncertainty. There will be some big changes basically. Because he's the 8th Lord and he's in 8th as well as 10th from Aruhi Lagna. So as far as the image of work that he's doing as well as the actual job that he's doing, in both the things there will be some uncertainty, there will be some changes during this time. So when you see 8th Lord associating with 10th house or 8th or the 10th from Aruhi Lagna, any one of them or two of them or all the three of them, if you see that, there will be some big changes during that particular phase in career. Now, are you done with Iti Pravesha or do you want to see something more, Palani?
It is also in A2, right?
Yeah.
A2 is also there.
So what is the meaning of A2? The second house is the house of resources. And A2, a planet in A2 will show?
Natural resources.
The actual resources that are at your command. The tangible resources that are at your command. So it may be a computer that you are given at work to do your work. Or it may be somebody that helps you. It may be some, if you are a software engineer, there may be a quality assurance engineer who is helping you. He may not really be your subordinate. He is just your colleague. But at the same time, he and all the equipment he has is a resource for your work. So A2 is all the tangible resources that you use in your work. And Mercury is impacting that. So there is a change in the tangible resources that you have. The actual work that you are doing and the resources that you are using to do your work. There is a tangible change. So there is some uncertainty, either change or some uncertainty relating to that. You may be thinking that you are going to get a particular resource for doing your work and there may be a lot of tension. Somebody else may want that person and you may worry, am I going to get this guy or not? Otherwise, we have to send a new rec and hire somebody else. And finally, you may get that guy. So that kind of things are possible when you see 8th Lord impacting A2. You have to use all the resources that you need for your work. It can be computers, it can be equipment, it can be software, it can be hardware, it can be people. Now,
but it also is in the 12th house, which is the house of giving, right?
Yeah. So what planet in the 12th house usually can show giving. You can give up something, you can compromise, you can lose something also.
Right.
But because it is the 8th lord who is in the 12th house, it ends up being good.
So bad you are giving up.
You are basically letting bad go,
okay.
Letting the tensions go. But you can't let tensions go unless you have some tensions. So Mercury will give some tensions. But at the end, the 8th lord being in the 12th, so you are giving away those tensions at the end. So he will give a lot of suffering, lot of frustration, but finally the frustration will be overcome and you will actually gain. The tension will be somebody else. You will give it away to somebody else.
It can also mean foreign language. If you start working in some other country,
yes.
From his birth country,
yeah.
They can identify that it could happen in a foreign land.
Any planet, basically any yoga that you see in the 12th house, that yoga can manifest in a faraway place. But we are looking in the context of this 1 year in which we know something about the person. So we can rule that out. Anything else?
Saramas.
Good for me. Sahamas. See, he is very strict. Usually teachers are strict. They tell students, do this, do this. But here I want to skip and go to the next thing, but he says, do this, do this. Okay, Sahamas. Now, Mercury is, where is Mercury?
Mercury.
He is in Leo, but at what degree? Mercury is at 847. 8 degrees, 47 minutes in Leo. Now, let's see if there are any Sahamas close to Mercury. Anything in Leo?
No.
I think I should give a view in which it shows how close each Sahamam is from a planet, basically arranged in the order of distance. Yeah, that will be a good.
Nothing is near
Mercury. Is there anything in Gemini Virgo, the signs worn by Mercury?
Virgo,
there is. Okay. Asha Sahamam. So, Asha is basically hopes and desires. Ratra Sahamam, brother.
Vyapara
Sahamam. Raja Sahamam, position. Putra Sahamam, Jiva Sahamam, basically overall career and karma, livelihood.
Vivaha Sahamam.
Artha Sahamam, money. So, one thing that you should be looking at is, look at, usually you don't find so many Sahamas, but here you find so many areas of life being touched by Mercury. Usually you don't find so many, you find two or three.
Why
and what you should be... Pardon me?
Why are you checking it with
Mercury? Because Mercury owns it.
Mercury owns
it.
Because there is nothing in Leo.
Nothing in Leo. See,
so we should
if there is a... Not only so, you should look at all actually. Even if there is something in Leo, you can look at Gemini Virgo. So look at the Sahamas that are owned by the planet, which are in the signs, owned by the planet, and look at the Sahamas which are close to that planet. And that are affected by that planet also, but the list increases. So let's focus on these. The Sahamas where, in the sign where the planet is, the planet doesn't have any responsibility towards them, but he has the power to influence it. It's like, I'm sitting in this room, it's not my room, I don't have any power over this room, but I can alter it. I can move this table from here to there, I can maybe break a chair if I'm bad, or if I'm good, maybe bring a new chair and put it because one chair is broken. So I can do all these things. So that is analogous to a planet occupying a house. He doesn't have any responsibility towards it, but those are the resources he is given. Those are the things that he is allowed to impact. On the other hand, the signs worn by a planet are his responsibility. Those are his agenda. So even though I am sitting in this house, if something happens in my house, I am concerned about it. I'll be making phone calls to fix the problem if there's a problem at my house. So that is basically analogous to the houses worn by the planet. So here, if a Sahamam is close to Mercury, you can say that Mercury is capable of giving results relating to that Sahamam. On the other hand, all the Sahamas that you find in Virgo and Gemini, Mercury has a responsibility towards those Sahamas. He wants to give results relating to all those areas of life. But is he able to give or not? That depends on? Not how close. Now, we are not talking about closeness. We are talking about signs worn by him. You are talking about Gemini and Virgo. So whether he will give the responsibilities given by Gemini and Virgo, that depends on who he is associating with. what kind of company is he in, and what are the resources at his disposal. So he is in the second house with all these planets. So if we see that the lord of the Vivaha Sahamam is with Venus, then he can give marriage. If the lord of Vivaha Sahamam, if he is with the seventh lord, he can give marriage. If he is in the seventh house, he can give marriage. Right? Similarly here, out of all the sahamas that we saw marriage, we saw...
There is one. Paradara Sahamam.
I saw it, but I did not say it. The difference is, you saw it, I saw it. You said it, I did not say it.
We derived a Saham from Vedic Shastras.
Paradara Saham.
So what you are saying is, there are actually two ways of doing it.
Yeah,
one is look at the longitudes in the divisional charts and use those to derive the sahamam.
Right.
Is that what you are saying? Or the second thing is, look at this longitude. For example, let us take, where is Rajasahamam? Rajasahamam is at 2 degrees 48 minutes in Virgo. Right? So if you see, if you look at that point, if you want to place it in Dashamsha, it will be in Taurus, if you do the math. So you can place that Sahamam in Taurus. That is one way. Which way are you talking about?
I'm saying to derive the Saham not just from the Rocky chart, but from the divisional chart.
So you are suggesting look at the longitudes in the divisional chart.
Yes.
That's a good idea. It's something that I haven't really researched into. It's a very good idea. You should try it. Okay? Good. So... the sahamams that we saw, what are the sahamams? We saw things relating to aspirations, brothers, then we saw Rajasahamam, which is power, and we saw, what else did we see?
Jiva Sahamam.
Jiva is basically livelihood. Saddha is dedication.
Vivaha Sahamam, Vyapara Sahamam.
Yeah.
And,
okay, these are the sahamams that we saw. Now, out of those, which are likely to fructify? Which ones Mitri is likely to give? See which planets Mitri is with. And who really dominates there? Out of all the influences on Mitri, who dominates?
Sun.
When I am at a place with the landlord of that place, I will basically be doing, everything I do is decided by that landlord. So Sun, being the lord of the house and being with all these planets, and also being the natural king, he will tell everybody what to do. That is Sun's job, that is what Sun likes. So Sun will really dominate. And what is Sun's agenda? He is basically the karaka for power, karaka for position, and also he is the second lord here of money, second lord of resources and money. So Artha Sahamam was one of the Sahamams, and Raja Sahamam and Jeva Sahamam were one of the Sahamams. So Vyapar Sahamam is also there. That's a good point.
But like here we consider more of Rajya Sahamam or Vyapara?
Because of Mars, if Mars is strong, okay. Mars is the planet for enterprise,
okay.
And Mercury is the planet for trading. If Mars and Mercury are stronger, then the results of Vyapara Sahamam can be given. But here Sun is strong. Sun is not a trader, he is not a Vaishya. Trading is basically a Vaishya thing. And Mercury is the Vaishya. And Mars is the aggressive guy, Mars is the risk taker, Mars is the military guy. So if Mercury and Mars are together, and if they are strong, then you can say that Vyapara Sahamam result will fructify or other Sahamams. But here, Sun is the strongest planet.
Yes.
So what you can guess is?
Raja
Sahamam, Artha Sahamam, because it's the second lord. Yes. So something, some impact on the financial position, some impact on money, that can be given by Mercury, and also some impact on the position.
Position
of the...
More number of people, not really reporting here.
Something like that, yeah. The kind of things are possible. So that is what you would expect based on the Sahama. Is there anything else you want to see, Palani?
Samsa ruler.
Okay. Samsa ruler. Mercury is in Yamamsa. So what does it show?
Beautiful.
What does a planet in Yamamsa show? Beautiful. What? Righteous, but more than righteous, basically
beautiful.
Doing things intentionally. Yama is the planet of, not planet, God of?
Dharma.
Just uphold Dharma with no passion. If you have passion, you can't uphold Dharma. If somebody is destined to die, let him?
Kill
it. Yeah, finish the life. And then after that, if he is destined to suffer for 100 years, send him into the rotting place for 100 years. That is Yama. So if you have to basically met out punishment or let somebody suffer, basically let somebody suffer without any passion. That is Yama. So Mercury is in Yamas. Yama Samsa. Is there anything else you want to see? So basically there may be some changes, because we saw based on other things that there will be some changes which will be beneficial to the native. So those changes may also require him to be very impassionate. Go through what is happening without any emotion.
He's in charge of the layoff.
Possible. Yeah.
Now, do we know now that the changes for its beneficial one or?
We saw that there is not the first thing that we saw. Great Lord Mercury in the 12th house.
Some good change in his career.
Some tension, but at the end, it was actually good for him. Now, do you want to use any other technique? Do you want to use Narayan Dasha?
Yes, I was about to ask. In Tithi Pravesha also, we can use Narayan Dasha.
We can, but Tithi Ashtapadi is much better.
Okay. That was good, actually. Narayan Dasha was good.
But Narayan Dasha would give you a broader scope, more definite thing, but not in the very short time frame, right?
For me? Yeah.
But if you want to look at the short time frame, like last week.
But if what happened in the last week is a very important event in the whole year, then it will show up in Narayan Dasha also. See, it is Leo. Okay. So, results of Leo will be given. Okay, let us go back to the natal chart and let's do Narayan Dasha. So, right now what Narayan Dasha is running? Capricorn Narayan Dasha. So, overall, how is Capricorn? Let's judge Capricorn overall. Our Dasha starting from Lagna or 7th house? Dashas are starting from the 7th house from Lagna. So keep that in mind. Now second thing, how is Capricorn Dasha? During Capricorn Dasha, Narayana is in Capricorn. And Capricorn is the 2nd house. The 2nd house, it has Shani and Guru, 2nd Lord and Lagna Lord.
Lagna is in Cancer.
Progress Lagna is in Cancer, right. Okay. So Progress Lagna is in Cancer. During Capricorn Dasha, the Progress 7th house is in Capricorn, which means Progress Lagna is in Cancer. So take Cancer as Lagna and judge the whole chart. What can you say based on it? First of all, during this Dasha, will there be a lot of interest in occult subjects?
Yes.
Why?
Ketu
in the 8th. Ketu is the Karaka for occult knowledge and 8th house is the house of occult knowledge. If you see Ketu in the 8th house from Dasha sign, you can say that there will be some occult study. But of course, if the person is not into occult at all, it won't happen. So see if that indication is there in the Rashi chart, natal chart. If it is there, during this Dasha, it will be at a peak. So there is Ketu in the 8th house, so some interest in the occult, especially Aquarius is a philosophical sign. So if Ketu is in Aquarius, very likely to have interest in philosophy and occult subjects. Now what else? The 2nd house has Sun and Rahu. What can you say based on it? Basically, is 2nd house strong or weak?
Weak.
Let's just be honest. Let's forget that this is special or chart. 2nd house is weak during this Dasha. And 2nd house basically is eclipsed. 2nd Lord Sun is eclipsed by the 8th Lord Rahu. So, in the family life, do you think that family life will be very smooth during this time? Or there will be a lot of changes, lot of upheaval? Yes. Now, 3rd house. How is the 3rd house?
Why
is it good?
Mercury
is exalted. Third Lord is exalted in the 3rd house and Yokarka is there. But 3rd house is a good house for benefic planets, malefic planets and not for benefic. Is Mercury a benefic or malefic here?
Mars.
Who remembers the exact rule of Mercury? Is he a benefic or malefic? Or both? Right. He changes his color based on who he is with. If he is with malefics, he is malefic. If he is with benefics, he is benefic. He is very flexible. Out of all the planets, Mercury is the most flexible planet. Now, so there are 2 malefic planets in the 3rd house. That is a good house for malefics to be. And one of them is exalted, one of them is in one house. One of them is Yogyakarta. So it's overall a period of it's overall a period of recognition and good karma, because Mars is the 10th lord and the 5th lord. So there will be recognition, there will be good position, and there will be good karma. And but the thing is, when the 10th lord is in the 3rd house, what are the results for that? 10th lord being in the 3rd house. Usually you can expect that person to be into contracts. Tenth lord in the 3rd is the house of short breaks or short jobs. So that person may not be in a full-time job. I know that that's not true for you, but in general, if 10th lord is in the 3rd house, they can be into contracts, they can be in temporary jobs, and there can be several breaks. There can be small breaks in the career during that time.
He could keep changing places.
He could travel a lot. 10th lord in the 3rd house means such a person can travel a lot on job, because 3rd house is the house of travel. And his agenda, 10th lord's agenda, is to give work. And 3rd house, being in the 3rd house, what he is capable of giving is travel. So he will use the travel for work. So that is how planets use the resources given to them based on which house they are in to further their agenda, which is based on which houses they own.
So that's often the house of initiative.
Yes.
So you give a lot of drive.
There will be a lot of drive in work. I mean, without drive, why would somebody travel a lot on work?
Yeah.
There is a link between everything. Third house is the house of drive, and third house is also the house of drive. Okay. Now, moon is in the 5th house.
Actually,
the Lagna lord moon is debilitated in the 5th house. So, is it good or bad?
Bad.
Just what does it show? Yes. If, basically, any debilitated planet in the 5th house. 5th house is the house of emotion. It's the house of emotions, it's the house of wisdom, it's the house of judgment. So, in the house of emotions, the planet of emotions, moon, the planet of mind, he is debilitated there. And he is Lagna lord. Basically, Lagna lord is debilitated in the house of emotions. So, this is a period of lot of emotional drain, basically. That's a good word. Say, dasha of emotional drain. What else can you say? Shani and Guru in the 7th house. Is it a good... what kind of aspirations will he have in this dasha? The aspirations of a person are seen from the 7th house from the dasha lagna. 7th house is the house of desires. What kind of desires does he have?
Jupiter is a lord of the 6th house.
And the 9th house. Yeah?
So, dharmic and...
That's when he gives you his own house. He's going to give him a lot of hard work, labor.
Yeah, but when you are looking at what kind of desires, just look at the nature of the planet. If there is sun in the 7th from dasha sign, there will be a lot of desire of power. The person will be power hungry. If there is Mercury, let us say, in the 7th, the person will be hungry for knowledge, hungry for learning. So, looking at the 7th from dasha sign, you can see what kind of desire the person has. So, what kind of desire do you see? Shani and Guru kind of desire. What are their natural significations?
Wisdom.
Guru, basically wisdom and traditional knowledge. So, there is a lot of desire for traditional knowledge, Vedic knowledge.
Very strong desire, because Saturn and Jupiter together.
No, both are retrograde. Planets that are retrograde show strong desires from past lives. So when you see, that's a good point. When you see any retrograde planet in the 7th house from dasha sign, the desire will come like a flood, as though it has been buried for a few lives or a long time. It will come like a flood. So the desire for Shani will also show desire for renunciation, desire for basically detachment. Shani is the planet of detachment and renunciation. So, there will be some desire to go away from the whole, from all this materialism. That desire will be strong. And Jupiter, he will give a desire. He will give a desire for traditional knowledge, Vedic wisdom, etc. Now,
debilitated Jupiter.
We'll come to that. So, now we are done with the desire. With seeing what kind of desires will be given. Now let us look at those planets as just two planets, not the planets who are showing desire. Now look at what houses they own.
Jupiter owns
6th house and 9th house. And he is debilitated but retrograde. If a planet is debilitated but retrograde, what kind of results will he give? As if he was exalted. On the other hand, if a planet is exalted and retrograde, he will give results as if he was debilitated. So Jupiter is practically exalted there. Is that good for overcoming obstacles? As far as 6th house is concerned, from Cancer, the 6th lord Jupiter was debilitated, which was good. It was part of Jai Yoga. sixth lord is debilitated. What is the other part of Jayoga?
Tenth lord strong.
Tenth lord should be strong, exalted theoretically. That's strict rules. Here tenth lord is not exalted, but he is with an exalted planet. So he does have Jayoga and Cancer in Kepigan Dasa, when you take Cancer as Lagna. But the problem is Jupiter has Nitya Bhanga. He is in Nitya, but he has Nitya Bhanga.
Because of
retrogression. So he gives results as if he is exalted. So sixth lord, exalted, he is not good. So Jayoga is actually broken. There is Jayoga Bhanga basically. There is a yoga for victory, but there is a breakage in that yoga. So things will go smoothly, but there can be some big disappointments also. So unfortunately, as far as sixth house is concerned, Jupiter does not promise good results for it. But as far as ninth house is concerned, is ninth lord's debilitation good?
No.
Ninth house is the house of Dharma. Ninth lord being in Nitya is not good. But ninth lord being in Uccha, is it good?
Good.
It is good. So Jupiter being having Nitya Bhanga, being in Nitya and having retrogression, that is bad for material things, for overcoming enemies. But it is good for Dharma. Now secondarily, being the ninth lord in the seventh house with the seventh lord, does he give any yoga? He gives a Rajyoga. What kind of Rajyoga will it be?
Vimala.
What?
Vimala.
No. What is Vimala?
Moon. Venus.
Moon and Venus what? Okay. Vimala Yoga is basically 12th lord in the 12th house. Hatha Yoga is 6th lord in 6th. Sarala Yoga is 8th lord in 8th. Vimala Yoga is 12th lord in 12th. So this is not Vimala Yoga, but it's just a Rajyoga. There is no name for it. 7th lord and 9th lord together is a Rajyoga. But what kind of results will it give? It will basically bring the 7th house and 9th house results together. What is the meaning? 9th house is Dharma, 7th house is
desire.
Desire and also
interactions
and associations. So when it comes to dharmic interactions relating to Dharma, there is a Rajyoga during this time, during this period. During this dasa, there will be a Rajyoga person. Okay.
Entry Pravesh chart.
It's not entry Pravesh chart. It's just Pravesh chart or entry chart.
Entry slash.
Yeah. Okay, good.
Capricorn from with respect to Lagna, actual Lagna.
Yeah. Capricorn with respect to Lagna, basically second house, so a lot of money, lot of resources. So Narayana, finally his point was, we directly jumped to Cancer as Lagna and analyzed from Cancer. We did not analyze from Capricorn itself. That was our first step, if you remember. Second step is taking it as Lagna. So based on the first step, Narayana is in Capricorn, and Capricorn has the second lord and Lagna lord, and especially second lord is strong there, Shani. So basically, he will make money. He will have money and resources. He'll have good comforts. He's Lagna lord also. So he'll be intelligent. His intelligence will improve. Lagna is your very intelligence. So intelligence will improve. His comforts will improve during this dasa. And he will have money. He will have resources. So that is what Narayana promises.
Do we also take the reference from
Madhu
Lagna here,
12
from
Madhu
Lagna?
There are so many things we can do, but just use the three principles I said. Where is Narayana? Take Lagna and judge. And third thing is Dasha Pravesha to see individual Antatasha. With that, you can give 80% of the results. So forget about other things. We will slowly get into that. Forget Arut Lagna.
Entry.
Okay, entry. Entry Pravesha. Entry slash Pravesha. Okay. So that chart has Gemini Lagna. How much leeway do we have? 145, 24 minutes. So we are safe. So it's not on a border. Usually it's not on a border, but it may so happen that a particular Dasha Pravesh Chakra, particular period entry chart, was right on the border. So in that case, you have to pay attention. So always when you see any chart, it's a good idea to see how much leeway you have on both the sides. Now, the Antardasha that is running right now, he is running Scorpio Antardasha right now. Right? Capricorn, Scorpio. What kind of results will Scorpio give?
Sixth lord
is in Lagna. So what are the results of it? It's basically, it will give the results of sixth house. And its lord is in Lagna. So what is the, what overall during this whole year, what is the result that you would expect?
There
will be a lot of obstacles, lot of work to do, lot of hard work, and he will work hard basically during this whole under the sun.
And the Capricorn is the 8th house.
Pardon me?
We are looking Narandasha for Capricorn. That means
yes.
We are
looking at Antardasas.
Capricorn, Scorpio is
Scorpio
6th house. So you could call it a 10th house.
What would you expect, for example, in Libra Dasha? Libra Antardasa?
He's a very effective house. Of course, yeah? Rahu Kandali Yoga is there because of Rahu.
Because of Rahu, Guru Chandal Yoga is there, and the presence of Venus and the fact that this is Venus house, will it increase Guru Chandal Yoga? Will it make Rahu stronger or Jupiter?
Rahu
is much stronger now. Because Venus is the teacher of demons and Rahu is his favorite bad guy, his favorite demon. And they are all, they both go together. They are pounding on Jupiter. So this is Guru Chandal Yoga aided by Venus, supported by Venus. So Jupiter will?
No, not dominated.
Jupiter is not dominated. Jupiter is struggling.
No, Jupiter is suppressed.
Jupiter is suppressed. Now, basically what will be the focus during this Antardasha, Libra Antardasha, during 2003 September to 2004 September? What will be the main event during that 1 year? Will it relate to career? Will it relate to child? Will it relate to wife? What will it relate to?
Child.
Fifth house
is children. So is it good for children?
No.
Well, question is, Rahu is there, but Venus and Rahu are both strong.
Yeah?
So
whose agenda is child here?
Venus.
So he is strong. He is aided by Rahu there, his friend Rahu. So as far as child is concerned,
it is good.
It is a good period for child,
right.
But it is good in a Rahu way, Venus Rahu way.
So foreign influence or whatever.
Yes. Do you expect some changes in child's life?
Yes.
Because there is a big tug of war going on between Jupiter, Rahu, Venus, etc. So it's not good for, during the Antardasha, you can expect some changes in child's life.
More in a Rahu way. Because
more in a Venus way.
Venus.
See, the thing is, Rahu himself is different from Venus with Rahu. Venus is the guru. So he's the guru of Rakshasa.
So
he will keep the Rakshasa in check. So when Venus and Rahu are together, Jupiter may be broken. Jupiter may have to leave. That's a different matter. But still, Rahu will not do really terrible things.
Correct.
So Rahu, the Rakshasa, will basically be kept under check by Venus. And Venus is also, you have to remember that Venus is not only the teacher of demons, but he's a great yogi. If you want, we talked about Tapas Yoga earlier. Who are the planets who give it?
Venus,
Saturn and Ketu. Venus is basically, he is a great yogi, Mahayogi. Out of all the Maharshis, do you know who Vishnu says he is? He doesn't say, I am Jupiter among all the Rishis, or I am Vasishtha among all Rishis. Rishi Nam, who is he? Rishi Nam. Bhrugu. So he says that he is Bhrugu among all the Rishis. And Venus is that Bhrugu's son. So Venus is a great Maharshi. When you see a strong Venus influence on the fifth house, during that period, the sun may be very disciplined. He may go into yoga, etc. also. So, but whatever it is, looking at the tug of war in the fifth house, you can expect some big changes in child's life. If you look at Saptansha, you can give more clear results. But just based on this, there will be some important events happening in child's life. What about wife? Is it a good period? For husband and wife, the marital relationship.
No, because seventh house lord is Jupiter.
Yes, you have to realize that when you look at Antardasha, don't just see what house it is. See what house lords are there. So seventh lord Jupiter is there, but he is totally destroyed there by Venus and Rahu. So during this dasha, it is an important dasha for child, and for marital relationship it's not such a good Antardasha. There will be some tension relating to marriage. Now what are the other lords who are here?
Rahu,
who is the lord of?
Ninth
house. So ninth lord, Rahu is also there. Is he good or bad?
He's
strong. He is basically with Venus. So is it a good period for Dharma?
It is good.
So that Antardasha is a very good Antardasha for Dharma, very good Antardasha for children, but a not so good Antardasha for
spouse.
Either for spouse or for the marital relationship. It may be that relationship is good, But wife has a disease or something. There is some tension about wife. Or it is also possible that wife is healthy, but we have tension about wife. If you want to clearly see which one it is, you have to go to Navamsa. Realize that you are looking at Narayan Dasha of Rashi chart. It is valid for everybody born in the 2-hour period. So there will be some patterns that are similar between you and other people who are born in the same 2-hour period. But the exact manifestation may be different based on other factors, based on the Navamsa, based on the Dashamsa, etc. So this is how you can see. And right now,
it's also the house of ability.
Yes. Yeah.
So all those will also flourish.
Yeah, they will flourish. During that time, his capabilities will basically be recognized well. Yes.
Even 10th Lord, Jupiter is also 10th Lord. So even
but it is bad. 10th Lord, being the 7th Lord, he can give some problems in marriage. Being the 10th Lord, having Guru Chandala, can there be some kind of
career-related
problem? You were laid off once during the Dandar Dasha, right? Towards the end of the Dandar Dasha. That is quite possible. If you see, in the Dasha Pravesh Chakra, if you see Jupiter associating with the 10th house and having Guru Chandala Yoga, you can say there will be some death-like situation in career.
And from the boss. It can come from the boss.
Right? That can come from boss because Rahu is 9th Lord. Is that how you are saying? Yeah. Very good. Excellent. Okay. What do you want to do now?
The next one, current one.
Before we do anything, let me restart.
Scorpio,
we already saw. We said that this whole Antardasha is basically an Antardasha of obstacles, some enmities, etc. And he will overcome those. That's what we said. But do you think that there is enough in the Narayan Dasha to pinpoint what happened in this particular week?
So what I mean to say, Scorpio entry chart, did we see?
Yeah, to see further division.
Oh, okay.
Well, you can, but let's stick to Antardashas for now.
Okay.
And if you want to focus on a particular period, let's look at Tithi Pravesha. That is how we will do for a few more months. Let's not go into present Antardasha.
We saw some change in the job, and which is resulting going to be good.
Yeah.
And then some gains.
Yeah. So, anybody in the class wants to add any more thoughts before Seshu Garu tells us what happened to him?
So, we can expect for a treat. He got resources of money.
Yeah. So, Arthasavam and Rajasavam, some increase in position. At some. But usually when you see Vipritha Raj Yoga, the increase in position is at somebody's cost.
Yeah.
We did.
In
the Dasha Pravesh Chakra. What we saw was Scorpio was the 6th house and his Lord was in 1 Lord in 11th house of gains, 1 Lord in Lagna. So if 6th Lord goes into Lagna, what does it mean? Lot of obstacles. And basically the Lord, Mars, whose agenda is obstacles, he's sitting on your head. Lagna is your head, your intelligence. So he impacts your intelligence. So you have to basically use your head always to fight off, ward off evils, fight off troubles. So overall this year is a year of obstacles and he will be working hard to overcome those obstacles. Okay.
But do you want to go to Tithi Pravesha? That's where Rajan Siram were looking at it. And
yeah,
we timed the events and how the result could be
from
the Tithi Pravesha actually.
We did it at the beginning, right?
Yeah, we did it at the beginning.
That's what we did in the beginning. We started with Mitri.
So the thing that exactly happened, which I didn't have with you last time around, last week around this time.
Yeah.
Is last Sunday somebody called me, set up an interview on Wednesday.
Yeah.
The result on Thursday morning.
Yeah.
Offer letter on Thursday evening.
Yeah.
I gave my notice on my existing job on Friday.
Uh-huh.
So all these things happened in 4 days.
Exactly 4 days. Good. Does it involve more money and more position?
It involves more money because it's less money than what I make.
Yeah.
But it is overall more into my pocket because I save on mass taxes, I save on
accommodation,
commute.
This is in New Hampshire itself. So you don't have to commute 60 miles.
I commute 8 miles, 7 miles, 6 miles.
Okay. So you also accepted the offer?
I accepted the offer and gave notice at this place yesterday, the day before. So.
Okay. Okay, so what we said is, 8th Lord in the A10, we said that A10 is the formal job. There will be some change in the formal job, like from principal engineer you become something else, manager, or from software engineer, you become diagnostics engineer, or from engineer at Microsoft, you become engineer at IBM. Some change in the tangible aspect of the job, we said, will happen. If your HLRD is in the A10, so that indeed happened. Okay.
Change of job and more money yeah. left over.
Yeah.
And other things are right too about the emotional drain and the change of other things, everything is true.
Yeah. Good. So, HLRD basically gave a change. The HLRD.
Yeah.
Unexpected change, yeah.
Was there anything that was completely on the track?
No. It was everything right on.
Okay, good. So, good job, class.
Somebody's call.
Somebody in the
Now, anybody else has any thoughts that you were trying to explain and could not explain, we'll take up. Because we have half an hour more, we'll take up one more chart. If anybody has anything.
You want to look at my chart. December 29th, something happened.
One second.
One more quiz.
We like three.
Okay, there you go.
The data he must
be knowing. No, actually I have the data, but I don't know if it's right. Because your data keeps changing. What is the latest data? What? Five? Whose education?
Yours is Anil.
Okay, cool. November 23, 1966, 5:09:45 AM, Indian Standard Time, Tiruvallur, India. 79 degrees 55 minutes east, 13 degrees 9 minutes north. On December 29, 2004,
afternoon around
2 o'clock.
Forget it.
So on December 29th, is it an important event, is it a significant event, or something small like you drank milk?
Something more significant than drinking
milk. Okay. So an important event happened to him on December
29th. What's your name?
Suresh. Suresh Babu Chandra.
So he met Rajnikant on that day.
What do you want to check out? Aishwarya Rai also? Oh, I didn't know that. You hid it from me. Then I wouldn't have criticized her in front of you.
But you were thinking of criticizing her?
What?
You were thinking of criticizing Aishwarya Rai?
Yeah. I did it many times in Sindhu. I don't like her. But let us stick to astrology. Okay. That's us. You want to see, first see the, this is the Tithi Pravesh chart? No, this is not. Okay, this is the Tithi Pravesh chart. The data is November 22, 2004, 1:40:47 AM. Horalad is, who is the ruler of year? Jupiter is the ruler of the year. Okay. Let's go to the dashas directly. December 29. So Mercury dasha, Jupiter under dasha is running. Was running at that time. Actually, it is still running, Mercury dasha. Now, to make it easier, Suresh, to make it easier for the class, Can you roughly give an idea of what area so that they can focus on the divisional side? Pardon me? Career. So something related to career happened. An important event in career happened. Now, look at D10.
Again,
Voga of what? Oh, from Mercury to Jupiter?
Right.
But see what Mercury promises. Forget the Andhra Dasha, Prachanda Dasha, Sukhmanta Dasha, Dehanta Dasha, Pranantha Dasha. You get Dasha.
second.
Okay, I will remove the present dasha, antardasha. Just look at dasha. Mercury dasha is from December 15 to February 13. What kind of results does Mercury show in Kerala?
Second house, Mercury house, and sitting in the 12th house is second. It's pretty strong in the 12th
house. Oops, 40, 21 seconds later, this lagna will change. See, this is what I told you. I told you that you should always look at how much leeway you have on both the sides. So irrespective of who rectified it, what? See, 21 seconds later, the Rashi Lagna changes from Leo to Virgo. So now, you have to be sure that the time that he gave you is not off by 21 seconds.
Right. Yeah.
Unless you use, based on the events that you use, in the natal chart, let me tell you what I mean. Go to natal chart. What is the uncertainty we have here? 1.5 hours and 36 minutes. So just because the lagna in the Rashi chart, natal Rashi chart is in the middle of a sign, doesn't mean it will be in the middle of a sign every year. So on, in one particular year, it may be on a border. So you have to look at the leeway you have on both the sides every year in every divisional chart. Then only you can be sure that the data is right. Actually, Suresh, I refuse to put the conscience of the class.
But you can try it, right? It could be correct also. It could be a correct rectification.
Yes, no. This time is right. Let's see.
Yeah. Okay, assume that this time is right.
If it doesn't count, it doesn't.
You just give it a try. If it's not right, then this time is wrong. He has to go back and figure out the correct time.
At least unproved to me that I have seen right.
Okay. What do you expect in Mercury and Mercury
Dasha? Second house lot and fifth house lot sitting in 12th house strong in second.
Yeah. First of all, whose results will Mercury give in career?
Saturn.
So Mercury will give Saturn results, period. And what are Saturn's results?
Saturn is a lot of the
9th and
8th.
Saturn is a lot of?
Lot of
9th and 10th.
9th and 10th houses.
Exactly.
Good or bad?
Good.
He is Yokarga, not Dharma Karmadpati. You don't say, for Taurus Lagna, 9th and 10th are owned by the same planet. So you don't say Dharma Karmadpati Yoga to some extent, but you say he is a Yokarga. Okay? Basically, the planet, same planet has responsibility for both.
But that's never yoga. That's
fine. Let's say yoga, but it's not a Raj Yoga. You just call him Yokarga. The planet is a good planet. He will bring luck. He will bring success.
And in 12th house of
okay, irrespective of which house he is in, the Yokarga is always a good planet. So Shani shows good results. But he is in the 12th house. What does 12th house show?
Giving up.
Giving up something, losing something, compromising something. So it shows something like some letting go.
So letting go in career and in dharma.
Letting go in career. Basically, we are talking about career. Yeah.
So you're giving up hard work.
For me?
You're giving up hard work for something? No.
Not necessarily. The natural significance planet never gives away. It gives away is the houses that he owns, attributes.
Okay.
Ninth lord in 12th house, so he can give up his boss. That means he can ignore his boss. 10th lord in 12th house, he can ignore his work. Or he can give up some position or something. So those are possible, but Saturn in 12th doesn't mean he will give up hard work. He will actually have to work hard. Yes, that is the... Now look from Arul Lagna, from status point of view, from image point of view. From Arul Lagna, Saturn is in the third house. Is it good? Saturn in the 12th house, why is it not good?
Second is Manakarka, third is...
Who is Manakarka?
But Saturn third house is good.
Second house.
Is Maraka, not Manakarka, Maraka, yeah. Yeah. But Maraka, it's not only Maraka. For Arudha, second is also the food. Second house is the house of food. So second from Arudha is the food of your image. So what nourishes your image? What builds your image? So if you have Shani there, it's bad. Because Shani doesn't have enough food to give your image. But Jupiter there is good. Mercury there is good. So for natural benefits, second in Arudha is good. For natural benefits, second in Arudha is bad. But forget that. We are not talking about second. We are talking about third.
Okay.
From Arudha Lagna, what is the result of benefits in the third house? Yeah, if benefits are there in the third from Arudha, is it good or bad?
No.
When you are talking about Arudha, it's basically image and status. So there, The third from Arudha, if it has benefits, he is seen as somebody who doesn't have initiative. Okay? It is good if you are a sannyasi, but it is bad if you are a working person. Any planet in the third, it does not give you initiative. That is from real third. The Lagna is the real you. Arudha is not the real you. It is what people think you are. It is the image that people have in their minds. It is what you are projecting in the minds of people.
So, even in their projection, if initiative,
it could be the benefits. When it comes to Maya, the rules are clear. Benefits, if they are given charge of giving initiative, they will not give initiative.
So
benefits are always, they will make you look very bold. Mars in the third from Arudha Lagna, he will make you look very bold. Saturn in the third from Arudha Lagna, he will make you look very selfish, who has a lot of drive to get things for himself. Rahu in the third, he will make you look like somebody who can cheat other people, who can do anything to other people to get what you want to get. So if you are looking at a materially successful person, people think that he will get whatever he wants, man. He's really successful. If he wants something, he will get it. Probably he has benefits in the third and sixth from Arudha Lagna. On the other hand, if there is a benefit in the third from Arudha Lagna, the image will be that of somebody who has no initiative, no drive. He doesn't care if he gets something or not. And if you are talking about a material person, that image is bad. But if you are talking about somebody who is spiritual, it's actually better.
Right,
it's the right image for him. So we are talking about, when you talk about Arudha Lagna, you are strictly talking about image. So what is good for goose is not good for gander. So that applies very correctly in the case of Arudha Lagna. So you have to see whether this goose or gander when you apply Arudha Lagna. Then you will get a good result. In any case, let's forget that he is a spiritual person. Let's forget about his spiritual image. Let's look at his actual image at the workplace, material in the materialistic sense. So from that sense, pardon me? forget that. We don't care. So his placement in the third from Arudha Lagna is good. Malefic in the third makes somebody look like an achiever. But he is debilitated. If he is debilitated, then again it's bad. If a malefic planet is debilitated, he will act as if he is benefic. If you see Saturn, debilitated Saturn in the third from Arudha Lagna in somebody's chart, you can conclude that he will have a lot of initiative, but it will fizzle away. The initiative fizzles away. Pardon? I'm coming to that point next. Forget that he's retrograde. If he is only debilitated, the result is he will have a lot of drive. Not actually have. He will seem to have a lot of drive, but the drive will seem to fizzle out with time. So that is what debilitated malefic shows. Now, he is debilitated and he is retrograde. So actually debilitation is cancer. He will act as if he is exalted. So that is good. So the overall result is there will be ups and downs in terms of drive. But overall, materially he will appear to be an achiever. Somebody who, a go-getter. He will basically appear to be a go-getter materially. So from Arudha Lagna, Saturn is well placed. And from Lagna, he is the 9th and 10th lord in the 12th house of giving up. So what do you conclude?
So he is strong because right now he is as good as Saturn. The Nikshanga is there. So it's like the natural strong Saturn sitting in the 12th house.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So overall, will it involve some kind of giving up on his part?
Yeah.
But which does not make him look like a loser. Which actually makes him look like a winner.
Yeah.
Is that what you would expect based on this? So that you would expect in Mercury Dasha, overall Mercury Dasha, not just that particular day. Overall Mercury Dasha. And what about that particular day?
Mercury
Jupiter. What is the result of Jupiter?
29th.
Yeah. Where is the Bhoga? From Mercury, if you look at Jupiter, he is in the 7th house. From Jupiter, if you see the 7th house, it is in 12th house. So what is actually experience, the bhoga, is in the 12th house. So what?
Giving up something he gave up on the 29th.
Yeah. Relating to on 29th or a few days.
Few days. He gave up something.
What?
He quit his job. No. He gave up something in his job. So it's got to be related to him.
Yeah. If he quit his job, you will see 8th house and 3rd house stand up. 8th house is long break and 3rd house is short break. If you don't see that, if you just see 12th house, it only shows giving up something. Even in his case, mystery is in the 12th house. He gave up his job. But he has a new job. But in his case, he is not only 12th lord in the 12th house of letting something go, but he is the 8th lord of a break. That is why he actually resigned the job during the Antardasha. But in his case, mystery has nothing to do with 8th house. So it's not really leaving a job, quitting a job. But it is some kind of giving up in the job.
Also, I think some gain he gave up. Because if I look at it, Jupiter is sixth house, sitting in 6th house, but in the Lord of 11th house, which is a house of gain. So he gave up some gains in his case.
Okay.
Do we need to see the Amsa to see?
Yeah. You don't need to, but you can. Actually, you don't need to see anything. You can just say whatever you want. Some people do that also, but if you want, you can see it. Okay, Mercury is in?
Indra.
So, Mercury is in Indra Amsa. So, overall, Mercury Dasha, is it a Dasha when his power will be accepted, his position will be accepted, or is it a Dasha of trouble?
Rising power.
Yeah, it's either rising power or exertion of power. That is what Indra shows, okay?
Sahama?
Okay. What in Sahama?
What is Mercury's degree?
Mercury's degrees. Mercury is at 27 degrees in Scorpio. Anything in Scorpio? Jiva Karma. Which one? Dhratra. Brothers. But he said it's relating to Keri. So let's forget Dhratra. Jiva and Karma. So this is activities and livelihood basically. So something that impacts livelihood. Mercury has an opportunity to impact the livelihood and impact the karma that he does. And anything in the houses owned by Mercury? Shatru. But anything relating to Shatru here, 6th Lord or 6th Karaka, not really. So forget D10. We are now, let's focus on Rashi chart when we look at the Sahama. Jupiter is the Hora Lord. Oh, okay. In any case, Shatru Sahama is not really being activated during the Antardasha. So what else? Jajya. Who's Paka?
Cancer.
You mean Bhoga, okay.
Oh, sorry, Bhoga.
Yeah?
Bhoga.
Yeah?
And cancer has Saturn, who is the 6th Lord.
Okay. Good point, yeah? Good. So actually, Shatru Sahama is also possible then.
To give up something for his enemies, they will give him to gains.
But the 6th Lord in 12th house is good.
What?
No, but actually what happened was, I had an argument.
Yeah?
Four of us, six of us kind of thing with my
colleague.
Uh-huh. Who shares office with me.
Uh-huh.
He's been with you for a long time.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. He's my colleague for like 5 years. My friend.
Okay.
So we had an argument that reached a boiling point.
Uh-huh.
We both were almost in... Yes, we have to very sustain in peace.
So those things happen in workplaces, I think. I never saw them, okay.
That prompted me to prepone my going to India by
3 months.
Yes. Like the atmosphere after that thing.
Mm-hmm.
So what is it we gave up here, the friendship, or?
So what I gave up was a few more years, months of gain, salary.
So, but you didn't leave the job.
I decided to leave earlier than I was originally.
He was going to leave the job in June. He decided long back.
But it doesn't show leaving the job or anything like that.
He didn't leave the job then.
Okay.
He only decided during that time, he decided, okay, I'm not going to stay till June. I'm going to decide to stay only till March. he decided to give up. So there is some kind of loss, some kind of giving up, we said. And that is he's leaving for India. He anyway decided to leave for India. He sold his house, he's living in an apartment now. His wife and children are in India now, right? So he's anyway going. When did you sell your house? Sometime last year. He sold his house, family is in India. So he was going to leave in June, but he is now leaving earlier. So some kind of giving up, some kind of compromise, that is working. And Jupiter, basically the Antardasha Lord, the Paka is in the 6th house, the Bhoga is in the 12th house, the Paka is in the 6th house. So the way he exercises his intelligence is based on where the Antardasha Lord is. So that is 6th house. So he exercises his intelligence to fight. So that is what Jupiter gave.
Also,
but at the same time,
it's not all of his favor. But conceived by the rest of the people who were involved, and both were at fault. So it was, third from our lagna did play his role of that being there. He was a
little as well. Okay. So do you guys think that this may actually be accurate, this lagna?
Probably.
Actually, if it's the next sign, will it be next sign? If it goes to Virgo, it will be the same. It will be the same. So Dashamsa is the same, Rashi will differ. Yeah. Now another thing, he thinks that he wants to leave for India in March. Do you see that in the chart? Now, if the class doesn't see it, you have to stay. Otherwise, you shouldn't have given your chart.
Otherwise,
correct the point. Yeah. First, let's see D10. What you see in Kirib?
March is...
Which planet give a long break in Kirib? Or a break? What are the houses of break I told you? Third and eighth. Third is a short break, eighth is a long break.
Yeah.
And Jupiter here is?
The Lord of the
eighth. Lord of the eighth house.
Yeah.
And moreover, what is this eighth house? It has Ketu. Ketu is in the eighth house. Ketu is basically the planet of dissipating things, of burning things away. And he's the seventh Lord. Seventh Lord in eighth house is a combination for Alpayush in natal first. If you see seventh Lord in eighth house or eighth Lord in seventh house, such a person will have a short life. He may not live for a long time. In Tithi Pravesh chart, if you see the combination in Dashamsa, there can be some death-like thing in career basically. Seventh Lord, that to Ketu is in the eighth house. So there can be a break in career during the year. And being the dispositor of that Ketu, not only the normal eighth Lord, but dispositor of such a Ketu. So Jupiter has that power. And when is his Dasha? It is coming in March, April, May time frame. So he may postpone by a little bit of time, maybe a month or month and a half. But before May 28th, he is likely to leave his job and go back to India. The original plan was basically to go in April, June or July or something right? In Rahu. So Rahu, does he show a break in the career?
No, shows traveling.
He took so. For me?
Third house is not good.
Which third house?
Second house.
So he doesn't really show any, he aspects the 8th house, a malefic aspecting the 8th house can give a break, but Jupiter is certainly more capable of giving it. So if you have to guess whether he will actually really leave for India, or is he going to stay for one more year, make his wife a fool, who is already in India, and stay for a few more years here, keep saying, three more months I'll come back. Do you think that's possible, looking at this Jupiter, knowing that he's expecting to leave in Jupiter the chart, do you think that there is a good chance that he will actually leave?
Yes.
So he's planning to leave in Saturn.
You are planning to leave in Saturn the chart?
I gave notice saying my last year will be March 11.
Okay. So he's actually thinking of leaving in Saturn the chart. Do you think Saturn can actually give the break, or do you think he may have to leave, he may have to stay for a little more time?
It is possible that 9th is possible to give up.
So do you think it can happen in Shani Dasha, or do you think somehow he will have to be involved in his job for a few more time? And actually the break will come in Jupiter, that's after March 21.
Only thing I'm thinking about, 3-9 is also there with Saturn.
Yeah.
So like, Arudha of 9th house being there.
Yeah. Okay, he will let us know later. He is basically planning to live in Saturn Dasha, which is possible. But Jupiter is likely to bring, so even after he leaves, for example, let's say he leaves, still there may be a few mails for him. How do we do this? What about this? So basically the complete detachment, cutoff is likely in Jupiter Dasha rather than Saturn Dasha. You booked your tickets, right?
Yes.
Okay.
You want to?
Okay. But if I didn't know anything from him, if I was going to guess when he would leave for India or when he would resign his job formally, I would have expected Jupiter Dasha, not Saturn Dasha, based on this chart.
And leaving is we have to see D4, right? From motherland.
Yes, to going back to motherland, yes. Okay. Who shows a travel? Which planet shows a travel and going back to the motherland?
Moon.
For me?
Actually, the fifth lord will show
that. The ninth. Fourth is motherland.
Fifth lord will take you back to your country. Fifth lord. Fifth lord in any D4.
Fifth lord in Rashi chart.
Drastic.
And planets associating with the 15 Chaturthams. If you are traveling, in general it is, if you are traveling abroad, it is the 9th lord. But if you are going back to your motherland, Lagna and the 5th house, those are important. Basically, 5th house is the house of emotions. And if you are going back, it's basically out of emotions. So, 5th house is the house of emotions as well as house of patriotism. And another interpretation is it's the house of Porupunya, so if you are going back to your motherland, it's because of your Porupunya. That's a philosophical interpretation. But logical interpretation is, it's the house of emotions, it's the house of patriotism, and you go back to your roots out of patriotism, out of emotions. So, Shani and Jupiter. I would have picked Jupiter. I would have, looking at everything, I would have thought that he would have left in Jupiter, that's an
accident.
They could, it could still happen that something comes up, he will postpone by a week or a couple of weeks. It's still possible.
Otherwise, you can always rectify the question when it comes in.
Yeah. Okay. Now, I will give you a puzzle. Now let's go back to Narayan Dasha, the Dasha that we've been learning. Now the data is September 12, 1971, 8:25 AM, Guntur, India. 80 degrees 23 minutes east, 16 degrees 13 minutes north. Those are the longitude and latitude. This chart belongs to a lady. What I want you to do is, look at Narayan Dasha. Look at Narayan Dasha, okay? In Leo Dasha, suppose this girl's father came to you in 1988 and he wanted to know when his daughter would get married. In 1988, she would be 17 years old. When do you see marriage? Just using Narayan Dasha, I want you to roughly guess when marriage is possible, okay? You don't have to come up with just one period. You can come up with two or three periods. As long as the right period is among them, I'll be happy. Now, is Leo Dasha capable of giving marriage at all? Now, you want to see whether Dasha started from Lagna or 7th house?
Yes.
Dasha started from the 7th house? Aries. So, Narayan Dasha in this case is a progression of the 7th house. So, take the 7th from Dasha sign to get the progress Lagna during a particular Dasha. So, in Leo Dasha, what is the Lagna?
Aquarius.
So during that dasha, is marriage a possibility?
7th house.
Actually, Narayan, you keep quiet. Somebody else.
No, I can give reason.
After this, everybody fails. Anybody?
Yes, sir.
Taking Aquarius as Lagna, during that dasa, is there a possibility of marriage? What is the house of marriage?
Seventh house.
Is seventh house strong?
Yes.
Venus is a little weak because of sun comes.
Yeah. Yes, Venus is a little bit weak. But sun is not bad here because he is the seventh lord too. Had Venus been in the seventh house with sun, sun would have weakened Venus, that would have been bad, if sun's agenda was something else. If sun's agenda was to not make the person get married, sun was, let us say, sixth lord.
Then
he would weaken the whole thing. If sixth lord sun was in the seventh house with Venus, he would dominate over Venus. Sixth lord always wants to give bachelorhood. Sixth house is the house of Brahmacharya. That is why Venus has Manakarka Sthana there. He doesn't want people to remain Brahmachari. So sixth house is the house of Brahmacharya. If sixth lord sun was in the seventh house with Venus, then Venus would have been suppressed and sun would have dominated, and the person is unlikely to get married during that time. She may remain bachelor. Because even though he is given charge of marriage by being in the seventh house, his agenda is sixth house, bachelorhood, being the sixth lord. So there would have been a problem. Here, even though Venus is weak, the karaka of marriage is weak in the seventh house, the person who is weakening him has the same agenda. He is the project manager of marriage. He is the pupil manager of marriage. The house lord is like, the analogy that we gave in the past is, house lord is like pupil manager and karaka is like project manager. So both are together and both have the same agenda. So because of that, there is a very strong chance of marriage during the dasha. So she did get married. So looking at the dasha pravesha, which antardasha would you pick?
Mars.
Seventh house is Scorpio. Seventh lord is
Mars.
What do you mean he is with Mercury? We are not looking at Tithyashto Tridasha or Vimsho Tridasha. We don't look at Mercury, Mars, extending results, etc. We are looking at antardashas of science.
We are. But even in antardashas, the effect of
we are not seeing Pakaboga and Narayandasa. We haven't done it. You are jumping ahead. You probably read more books and more articles. What we do is, look at the house, which house it is, which house lots are there. Depending on it, it will give the result. So, using the simple principles that we have covered so far, which antardashas are likely? In the dasha pravesh chakra, which is the house of marriage? Scorpio. So, Scorpio antardasha is a possibility. And where is the Scorpio lord?
Virgo.
There are two lords.
One
is in the fourth house, one is in the fifth house. Which one is likely to give marriage? The one in the fifth house. The one in Ketu is basically with an enemy, in the enemy's house. So he is not likely to give marriage. It is Mars. So which are the antardashas that you think are likely to give marriage? What?
Aquarius, because Yule is there.
Okay, good. Aquarius. Scorpio,
Virgo.
Those are the antardashas in which you expect marriage. And she got married in Scorpio antardasha, the seventh house.
Dharma.
Yeah. In general, my advice would be, go easy on the Arubhavadas in the dasha pravesh chakra. You can use them, but go easy on them. Just look at the house. So it is the seventh house, so it can give marriage. Simple. Now, in Ketrika antardasha, something important happened in her life. In Ketrika antardasha, which is 94 September to 95 September, something important happened in her life. Can anybody guess it? If somebody guesses it, I'll be proud.
What is that?
94 September to 95 September, which is Ketrika antardasha, an important event happened. Now, what I Okay, so what Sriram is doing is, for those of you who are not as fast, it is the ninth house and it has third lord moon. So what is the result? Okay, for fulfilling her dharma, she traveled somewhere. Very good. Any other guesses? Ninth house is dharma. Is it something else also? Third lord is travel. Good.
Protection.
Okay. Travel somewhere for father. For protecting someone? Okay, good guess.
For moon is for mother. Moon, mother.
Oh, okay. Travel somewhere for mother. What else? What is the other thing that the ninth house shows?
Fortune.
Yeah. So overall, is this a period when her fortune
blooms?
Yeah. Yeah. Ninth house. Antatasha of the ninth house. It can be the period when fortune blooms. Fortune in?
Foreign land.
Foreign land. Can ninth house give foreign travel?
It can give long
distance travel. So, is it possible that she left her mother country for the first time in this Antardasha?
Yes.
Is it possible?
Yes.
Very much. Good. And even if you look in the natal chart,
it's the fourth house.
Pardon me? In Leo Dasha, the Dasha Lagna was Aquarius.
Yes.
From Aquarius, Capricorn is?
12th
house.
Long travel.
Yeah. So,
long travel.
Yeah, long travel. So she...
But what is the effect of it being the third lord?
Third lord? So a lot of travel during that Antardasha. Lot of travel, lot of initiative. Now, the lord of that ninth house, lord of Capricorn, he's in the eighth house. So is it overall a good period or bad period? The fortune blooms. But at the same time, the Antardasha lord, he's in eighth house. Saturn in the eighth house.
Anxiety, unexpected trouble.
Yes, unexpected trouble, instability, anxiety, etc. So that was also true. The native left her mother country. She went to South Korea with her husband in 95, at the beginning of 95. And she did not really like it there. She did not like South Korea. So she was there for 8 months, 7 months. And in the 8 months, she came to US. So this whole year, and also during that time, she was pregnant. So there was all the
rough
period basically. All the rough things happened. But it was a period when her fortune basically blew. So being the ninth lord, Saturn's agenda is, what is Saturn's agenda being the ninth lord?
Protect.
To give fortune. To give karma. That is Saturn's agenda. So in Capricorn Antardasha, Saturn will get a chance to promote his agenda. And his agenda is to give fortune. But he can give it through eighth house because that is where he is. That is what he has access to.
Changes.
It will give changes. It will give fortune through change. Fortune through uncertainty. So that is what you can expect. On the other hand, if Saturn was in the ninth house itself, then you can say that during that period, it is a very fortunate period and there isn't too much instability.
Yeah.
There isn't too much change. So that is how you use the house owned by the planet and the house occupied by the planet. You mix both. They are not the same. The way some people use is, he got married. Okay, look at the seventh house, seventh lord. Planets aspecting seventh lord. Planets that are with seventh lord. Planets aspecting seventh house. You mix all of those in one group, so you come up with a list of six planets. So if the Dasha and Antardasha belong to one of those six planets, they say, okay, event is explained. But you have to, pardon me? Yeah. So what you have to do is, you have to distinguish between the meaning of each parameter. A planet being in the ninth house and a planet owning the ninth house are not the same. They are different. They have different agendas, but there is some commonality. So if you understand the meaning of each factor, then you can make judicious judgments, and then you are more likely to make good predictions. So keep that in mind and practice a little more on Narayan Dasha. Don't go into fancy techniques. If you look at, for example, there is a book on Narayan Dasha by Sanjay Ji. It's the best book on Narayan Dasha. Actually, it's the only book on Narayan Dasha. So if you read that book, there are hundreds of techniques, and if you start using them, then the thing will be, any event you want to explain, there will be one technique which will explain it. So you will say, why did it happen? Oh, because he is in Kendra from Dharakarka. Why did it happen? Oh, because he is aspecting Upvada. So you will always come up with good justification of every event, but that's useless when you want to make predictions. So what I want you to do is stick to the basics. Stick to the principles that we have been doing in the last few classes. We'll do some more classes and we'll slowly go through other principles. The important thing with using many principles is to understand the exact meaning of that principle. Otherwise, you will mix up everything and you can always explain anything but never make predictions. So, look at a few more examples using the same approach. And if you have any doubts, if anything doesn't make any sense, we'll take up that example in the next class. So, with that, I'll end for today. Next week, we'll meet in the same place at the same time.
ओम शांति शांति शांति
something